Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And now let's try to finish the second lecture of yesterday. I tried to slightly reduce the material. And what we want to analyze is the possibility to compare and to validate the kinetic scheme on the basis of experimental data. And of course, it is useful to have experimental data obtained in ideal conditions. And ideal conditions are obtained typically in a reactor like the shock tube, the turbulent plug flow reactors, the rapid compression machine. In principle, they are homogeneous reactors. And in principle, the ideal condition allow to validate and to compare experimental results with the simulation. Now the key point is to verify how far this, all these reactors are really ideal. We have, of course, also a perfectly stirred reactor where the mixing is practically complete, and the result is that in all the volume we have the same concentration and temperature. These are always ideal conditions. Then we have several other possibility to compare with the experiment. So we have laminar flow reactor, laminar premixed planes, and in this case we have the effect of diffusion. So it's something that requires a better attention in term of simulation in order to account properly transport phenomena together with the chemical kinetics. And this is also true for laminar diffusion planes. So the objective is to try to work with the ideal reactors, and typical ideal reactor are plug flow reactor, perfectly stirred reactor, batch reactor, and in this case we have an ordinary system of differential equation with the initial conditions. The same is true for the batch reactor, ordinary differential equation with the initial conditions. In the case of the perfectly stirred reactor in steady condition, then the system is a non-linear system if we are interested to the steady problem. If we want also to analyze the dynamics of the perfectly stirred reactor, then we can write again an ordinary differential equation with initial condition. So if we try to analyze the experimental reactor and device, we have the rapid compression machine, the shock tube, the jet stirred reactor, the flow reactor, but as I mentioned, we can have also experiment done in the flat flame burner, counter flow burners, or we can also use information coming from isolated droplet in the microgravity in order to compare with the experiment. If we take the situation of a flame front inside a reactor, if we want to evaluate the laminar flame speed for a premixer system, is equivalent to have a flow reactor. But in this flow reactor we have a flame front, a sudden increase of temperature, so we need to account for dispersion, for mass, for effect diffusion, for mass and energy. And if we write the proper equation, mass conservation equation, species transport and energy transport equation, then we have to account inside the differential equations also the diffusion term. This is the difference between ideal reactor and flame, that is the complexity or the different type of equation we have to solve. But let's try to spend a few words about the reactors. What is the shock tube device? The shock tube device is a reactor where we have a high pressure zone, a low pressure zone, then we have a diaphragm, and as soon as we burn the diaphragm, we have a shock wave that is acting like a piston. So we have a very rapid compression of the reactant mixture. So in this way, pressure and temperature are instantaneously heated and pressurized to very high values. In this way, it is possible to analyze ignition delay time in the order of 0.15 milliseconds. There are several facilities around, and there are several data that are coming from at least some of these laboratories I mentioned, and of course there are several others units in different places. The shock tube device is an ideal reactor, and in principle is adiabatic, and that we have a batch adiabatic reactor. We have a shock, a compression, and then we can analyze the reaction in this condition. But there are shock attenuation and boundary layer interaction if we are looking to longer time. Until we are staying on 5 milliseconds, this effect can be partially neglected. The results we can obtain from shock tube devices are indicating the ignition, typically the ignition delay time. Once again, we have seen already a similar diagram. We have the ignition delay time versus the reverse of the temperature. So temperature is increasing in this direction. And we have in here isooctane and normal octane ignition delay time. And then we have several primary reference fuels or different RON. RON means research octane number. And the meaning is that RON 100, it means 100% of isooctane. Then we are rising with increase of normal octane inside the mixture until we are arriving the RON 0, that is pure normal octane. And normal octane is more reactive than isooctane, exactly due to the low temperature mechanism we discussed yesterday. And we can see in here both the information relating to the high temperature mechanism and the low temperature mechanism. Again, just to show, the difference are in the low temperature mechanism, or better, in the area where we have the NTC, the negative temperature coefficient. But if we go to the high temperature, we see that both isooctane and normal octane behave in a very similar way. So high temperature is less sensitive to the structure of the fuel. So we have high temperature mechanism, low temperature mechanism, and so on. But we can have also further information from shock tube experiments. Here are reported a typical multi-species time history. So along the time, people in Stanford is able to recognize the presence of different species, like in this case, not only the fuel, normal dodecane, but also the formation of ethylene, the formation of water, CO, and also some radical like OH, methyl radical, and so on, can be detected. So these are the information we can get from shock tube experiments. Now if we go to the rapid compression machine, okay, instead to have a diaphragm, we have two pistons that at time zero are compressing a small chamber where reactants are contained. Once again, we have a sudden increase of pressure and temperature. Once again, we can try to say that this reactor is in some way an ideal reactor where the conditions inside the chamber are practically uniform. And again, we have a condition similar to an adiabatic batch reactor. Really, if we are trying to see at this rapid compression machine in Galway, Karan and Sang, they studied what is happening inside the chamber after the compression, and they observed that there are vortices inside. And in studying the homogeneity of the chamber, they realized that it was useful to modify the piston, to introduce some crevice piston in order to avoid the recirculation inside the chamber and in order to increase the uniformity of the system. So both the unit, shock tube and rapid compression machine are practically equivalent in some way. And if we try to compare the results obtained with the shock tube and the rapid compression machine, we can see that something is not properly working in a very ideal condition. Here are reported some results obtained relating to the propane ignition delay time. And reported for shock tube and for rapid compression machine. As I mentioned, rapid compression machine is able to detect longer ignition delay time. Shock tube, usually, it refers only to a maximum of 5 milliseconds. And what we can observe is that in this condition, there are large differences between the shock tube and the rapid compression machine ignition delay time. So it is necessary in some way to understand the meaning of this, and we can see that inside the rapid compression machine there are some so-called facility effects that are disturbing the ideality of the mixture. In principle, we have the compression, we are evaluating the ignition delay time, this is the experiment. But if we try to make an experiment with a non-reactive mixture, so we are taking an experiment where nitrogen is replacing oxygen, so we are not expecting any kind of reaction inside our system. And then we can see that after the compression we have some heat losses that are here reported in terms of a reduction of volume, and it is possible on the basis of this test to evaluate some volume profile in order to modify the assumption of a really a batch reactor. In this case, the heat losses are described in terms of reduction of volume inside our system. Now, if we try to make a comparison between the simulation without the correction or with the correction due to the facility effects, we can see in here that the results are quite different. Here are simply simulation, accounting or not for the facility effect. And the results are 20 milliseconds versus 60 milliseconds in the simulation. That means that this facility effect can be very important in order to explain the deviation in respect of the ideality. And the same is also true for shock tube devices. If until we are staying on relatively limited ignition delay time, the shock tube is quasi ideal. But if we are taking into account a longer time, 6,000, 8,000 microseconds, then it is possible to observe that there are derivatives of the pressure in respect of the time. So if we go back to the previous ignition delay time of propane, and we observe that the original simulation of the shock tube, that was the Fuchsia line, we can observe that if we are including the derivative of pressure in respect of the time equal to roughly 7%, of course this is an empirical value, we can better reproduce the result of the shock tube experiment also at longer ignition delay time. And in the same time, with the facility effect, the model is properly able to reproduce the data of the shock tube, the rapid compression machine experiment. Now, if we go to the jet stirrer reactor, once again, we have a very ideal reactor where all the volume is assumed to have the same concentration, the same temperature, all the parameters are equal inside the volume of the reactor. The reactor is a small reactor of about 30 cubic centimeters. This is the jet stirrer reactor in Orleans. Dago produced a lot of experimental data in this reactor. There are four injectors that are helping in having a good mixing inside the reactor. Of course, there are several other jet stirrer reactors around the world, and it is possible in this reactor to analyze the conversion of different mixture in different conditions in terms of pressure and pressure, temperature, and stoichiometries. As an example of results, here are reported results relating to a butanol normal heptane mixtures until we are staying on the CNRS, the Orleans CSR jet stirrer reactor. We can say that usually they are working at 1 atmosphere or 10 atmospheres. And of course the contact time is also related. There is contact times that are in the order of 0.7 milliseconds in the case, 0.7 seconds in the case of high pressure, and lower time in the case of the lower pressure. Then after the jet steel reactor, we can move to the plug flow reactor. And again, a very typical one is the Princeton variable pressure flow reactor, where several experiments have been produced and several experiments can be found in the literature. I took this slide from the site of Professor Dreyer, that was producing really several of this information. A key point in this case is, the operating conditions are reported in here, so we can go up to 10-20 atmosphere, and residence time typically is 120 milliseconds, but rising with the pressure, it is possible also to increase the time. The key point or the difficulties are related to the injection system. Of course, we can have an evaporator, and then we have a fuel injector diffuser. But really, the key point is the mixing zone. We have at the very the entrance of the reactor, we need to have the fuel, then we have the oxidizer, and here we have a mixing zone. So it takes some time to have the proper mixing. So usually, when we are comparing with the results of a plug flow of this kind of reactor, it is necessary to shift maybe of 20-30 milliseconds the results in order to compare with the experiment. Now, until we are taking simply a mixing zone where no reaction takes place, everything is in some way simpler, because we have only to shift the profile we are obtaining. In other words, I'm saying that the total contact time partially is given or is spent in order to have the mixing of our reactants, and then if we are looking at the profile we are obtaining, simply by shifting the profile, it is possible to compare with the experiment. But in several occasions, there are also reactions inside the mixing zone. A typical example is reported in here for tertiary butanol alcohol. And also for several oxygenated species, it is possible to observe that due to the very high concentration of the reactant in before the mixing, there is a significant reaction taking place. In this condition, I reported the results, and the results they show that the fuel concentration is initially larger than that is really observed inside the test, and it is possible to observe that also here I reported the molar concentration versus the temperature. It is possible to observe that some isobutene and water are present inside the system, indicating that the molecular reaction of decomposition or dehydration of tertiary butanol is taking place in the mixing zone. Trying to observe a pyrolysis experiment, this fact is confirmed. In other words, it is possible to observe that there is the mixing, there is the reaction due to the large extent of concentration of the fuel. Then we can rapidly go through the laminar flow reactor. Of course, in the case of laminar flow reactor, usually we have, a clear profile of velocity inside the tube. We have different residence time for the different stream inside this reactor, and the results are of course different from what we can obtain in the case of perfectly steered reactor or plug flow reactor. In the case of laminar flow, we have some results that are intermediate between perfectly steered and plug and plug flow reactor. It is possible to account for the laminar for this laminar flow, taking into account an equivalent dispersion coefficient and trying to solve the problem in this way. Then I said that also experiments in laminar flames are very useful in order to further validate the model, And I think that Professor Seshadri and Professor Williams, they will discuss further this, this frame. Particularly, the counterflow diffusion frame are studied in the labs of San Diego, and very useful experiments are obtained from this kind of experiments. Now let me report just a recent paper of Egor Fopoulos that presented the experimental approach and the measurement, and depending on the pressure, it is possible to obtain several information from the laminar plane. And of course, rising with the pressure, the only information we can obtain are relating to the laminar plane speed, while in the lower pressure, it is possible to obtain good chemical speciation. And more than that, particularly in the counterflow experiment, it is possible to study ignition and extinction condition of the different plane. To summarize this kind of ideal experimental system and the simulation frameworks, I have in here a slide given by Carsten Holm from Budapest. And okay, we can say that the measurements are related to ignition delay time, concentration profile, laminar burning velocity. The facilities are the rapid compression machine, the shock tube, the flow reactor, the jet steam reactor, or the different flame. In terms of modeling approach, we said that we are using adiabatic for rapid compression machine, adiabatic system with facility effect, adiabatic system with constant volume, or we can modify this information and we can use a solver, either Kempkin or eventually D-Smoke, OpenSmoke, or other possible tool in order to solve this problem. Now, if we say that we finish the ideal, we have still something to say about the PIH and soot formation. We already discussed yesterday some basic elements about that. And let's say that I like to start with this, or to report this slide that was taken from a presentation of Adel Sarofim several years ago. And you can see the flame, you can see the soot as reported by Georges de Latour, but you can also observe the observation of Faraday, and he was already observing the soot formation and observing at the light that is due to the soot. Now, if we are trying to see at the soot formation in the atmosphere, and we try to analyze the first point we can observe is that there is a multimodal distribution of aerosol, and the soot is of course included in the aerosol particulate. But if we try to make an average in terms of number of particles inside the atmosphere, we can see that there are typically two peaks around 20 and around 100 nanometers. And if we make the average in terms of numbers, we can see that the dominant number of particles are in here. If we make the average in terms of mass, in terms of volume, then it's clear that coarse particles are dominating. So we can find in here that the particle of one micron or maybe 10 micron are dominating. If we try to see at the speciation or at the chemical composition of the atmospheric aerosol, we can also observe that in the large particle, in the coarse particle, there are mainly crustal elements. So large particles, they contain a lot of crustal elements. And if we move from coarse particle to very fine, ultra-fine particles, then we can observe that there is a lot of organic carbon, that is PIH. There is a lot of elementary carbon, that is soot. So what I'm trying to say with this slide is to observe two different issues. The first one is that soot and polyaromatic hydrocarbons are mainly contained in the very fine particles. And if we make an average in terms of numbers, fine particles are the dominating ones. If we make an estimation of the particle, the atmospheric particle, then we can realize that the coarse particles are prevailing, but are prevailing in terms of weight, are not prevailing in terms of effect on the human health. And here is the key point for the soot formation. Until we are faced with the large particles, they can block in the nasal cavity without big troubles. But if we are going to very fine, very small particles, they are interesting in the bronchioles, they are maybe interesting also the brain, or this is at least the study of Professor Robert Dorster of Rochester University. So, in terms of concentration, we can say that mostly the particles are very small particles in terms of number of particles. Then it's clear that if we go to mass concentration, we can say no, mostly are very big particles. But in terms of health effect, of course, the smallest are the most dangerous one. Now, we have already seen this light, and this is the way the soot formation is, the soot is formed. We move from methane, we form acetylenic compound, then we form the first aromatic ring, then we are growing up, we have the soot inception at about 3,000 molecular weight, a threshold for the soot inception is about 3,000, and then we have the formation of the first particle, and then we are growing up in some way. This slide reports the typical hydrogen-on-carbon ratio in respect of the molecular weight. And the soot has a very large molecular weight, an aggregate of different primary particles, and the typical soot composition is C8H1. The typical soot composition is in the range of 10-15% of 0.1-0.15 in terms of hydrogen on carbon ratio. If we try to better analyze the soot, we have the first very small particle in the order of 2-3 nanometers. They coalesce, we have an aggregation of very fine particle, but the surface to volume ratio are so large that it's possible to have a growing of the particle. So around the first nanoparticle, we are forming the primary soot particles that are in the range of 10-20 nanometers. In this particle, it is possible to observe at the turbostratic structure. So we can see that there are several layers of different polyaromatic structure, and there are two information we can get from the soot. That is the distance between the two aromatic layers, that is in the order of 0.35 nanometers, that is typically also for graphite. And then we have also another information, that is the length of the different fringe, in order to understand how the different aromatic layers they can compact in some way. So this is practically the way the polyaromatics, they are first of all compacted in some way, then they are organized in the particles, and then finally they can go through aggregate in order to have the soot, the formation of the soot. Key point from a chemical point of view are first of all the chemistry of acetylene, the chemistry of benzene. These are the fourth key point for soot formation. But after that, the soot formation can be explained at least in a large amount through the so-called ACA mechanism, hydrogen abstraction carbon addition, the mechanism proposed by Frankluck 20-25 years ago together with Haiwang. Then nowadays there are a lot of further information. You can find, let's say that recently we have a paper, our team in Milano with Stanford, with Haiwang, exactly on the modeling of soot formation in order to try to represent the different behavior of, so here are reported the distribution of diameters near to the burner. The distribution is not present, but as long as we go ahead from the burner, we can observe a bimodal distribution like the one is reported in here. So, let's say that finally I finished the second lecture of yesterday. Now we try to go. But I am in advance because my lecture is this afternoon. Okay. So if you have some clear question, I will try to give answer. We go to the third lecture and we have to discuss about the complex hydrocarbon mixture, and more than that, to the automatic generation and lumping procedure in order to try to build up or to develop and to have this detailed kinetics for a complex system. The complexity of the mechanism has been already seen and discussed in here, and we have seen that the mechanism is very complex, but in the meantime alkyl radicals decompose and form at high temperature they can decompose, or at low temperature they can go through the peroxy radical formation. And successive reaction of the peroxy radical explain low temperature reactivity. Now let's go back to the complexity of the liquid fuels. Liquid fuels are mixtures containing a large number of components. Here is reported the GC analysis of the paraffinic fraction, C11, C24, of a diesel fuel, and we see that there are a lot, or better, 11, 12, there are all the normal paraffins contained inside, but there are also a lot of noise in here that are the isomers of branched paraffins. So from one side it's very complex, from the other side we can say no, a typical kerosene composition always contain only branched alkane, normal alkane, cycloalkane, and some aromatics. So the species contained are always the same, and the species contained are paraffins, CnH2n+2, naphthenes, and we can have a cyclohexane, for instance, but we can also have two-ring cycloalkane like decaline. Aromatics. We have benzene, C6H6, CnH2n-6, but we can have also two-ring aromatics like naphthalene, CnH2n-12, or we can have also polyaromatic hydrocarbons where we have a larger number of aromatic rings. Olefins, CnH2n, moving from ethylene propylene, we can go ahead with this in this way. But let's remain on the oxidation mechanism of pentane. We have already seen that until we are staying at high temperature decomposition, pyrolysis reactions are preceding oxidation reactions. So let's say, in trying to define a detailed kinetic mechanism for high temperature condition. So a detailed kinetic mechanism for high temperature condition, it means first of all to define a detailed mechanism for pyrolysis reactions. Because we already said that alkyl radicals, large alkyl radicals, they can very fastly decompose. They have a radical, a lifetime of 10⁻⁶, 10⁻⁷ seconds, so instantaneously they disappear from our system. And again, we can say that high temperature mechanism is only reported in this way. We are forming alkyl radicals, we are decomposing the alkyl radicals, and then I put in green now this kind of affirmation, sentence, high temperature mechanism of alkane is not very sensitive to the structure of the hydrocarbon fuels. It's clear that if we are moving to aromatics or other families of hydrocarbons or species, maybe that something is also partially different. So high temperature radical is very low. What we need to describe in order to build up and to develop a mechanism, we have to define chain initiation reaction, a subtraction reaction, and then we can have isomerization or decomposition of the radicals. So we have to define only the kinetic parameter of these four reaction classes. Let's start from initiation reaction. Let's start in a very simple way from normal butane. chain initiation reaction of normal butane, we have to define a frequency factor and an activation energy. We can say that we are assuming for normal butane a reference, an initiation reaction of this type, 5.5 × 10^17 x per minus 82,000, and of course the units are second minus 1 over second. Now, the activation energy is the dissociation energy of the C-C bond. In order to form the two ethyl radicals, we need to break the bond. We need, but we know that usually we are saying that along the progress of reaction, the energy moving from reactant to product is going this way, and then this is the activation energy. But in the case of the formation of two radicals, we can say that the activation energy of radical recombination is practically nil, so the reaction path is something like this, and the activation energy really becomes the bond dissociation energy of our system. But if this is true, then on the basis of the bond dissociation energy, we can easily build up all the initiation reaction of all the different species. Again, we can see that the hydrogenation or the H bonds are stronger, are in the order of 100 against 84, 85 of the C-C bond. So, going back to normal paraffins, we can have either the breaking of the terminal group, a primary versus a secondary carbon atom, and the reference activation energy can be something around 84. But if we are breaking a secondary versus a secondary, then we are going down to 82. If we are faced with the isoparaffins, then the bond dissociation energy is reduced to 80 or even to 79, 78 if we have bond between secondary and quaternary carbon atom and this thing. One important difference is in the case of olefins, in the case of alkenes. Here it is not very clear, but there is a double bond. This is butene 1. One butene. And if we are breaking this bond, that is an allylic bond, due to the resonance of the allyl radical that we are forming, the activation energy, the bond dissociation energy is only 72. We are forming a very stable radical. That is, the meaning is that to form a stable radical is something that is easier than the other radical. So on the basis of this bond dissociation energy, we can easily define all the chain initiation reaction. So we can move and we can go to the H abstraction reaction. In order to clarify, in order to verify better the H abstraction reaction, then it is very useful to refer to the bond dissociation energy of the CH bond. And there are reported the CH bond in respect of the primary, secondary, or tertiary carbon atom. And we see that the bond dissociation energy for the hydrogen inside the ethane, an hydrogen in the terminal methyl group, is in the order of 98 and becomes 95 and 92 in the case of secondary and tertiary. What is the meaning of this? That if a radical has to catch an hydrogen atom, has to abstract an hydrogen atom from the molecule, he can do this on the basis of the energy required. So there are a different selectivity to abstract primary, secondary, or tertiary hydrogen atom. So on the basis of few data, if we have a reference rate parameter for the abstraction of H atom by H radical. H radical is abstracting to form H2, or OH is abstracting to form H2O. Methyl is abstracting to form methane. For all this, we can define reference rate parameter, and these reference rate parameter are referred to the primary H atom. And then in a relative sense are reported in here the rate constant for secondary. In red are reported the secondary H atom abstraction. Black is the primary, so we see that it's more difficult to abstract the primary radicals, primary H atoms, and it's easier to abstract tertiary H atoms. And due to the difference in the activation energy, we can also observe that there is a ratio that we can roughly say that around 1000 Kelvin to abstract a secondary H atom is 3 times faster than to abstract a primary one. To abstract a tertiary one is roughly 9-10 times faster and easier than to abstract a primary one. So we can have selectivity that are really well defined. But the key point is that only a few reference kinetic parameters are needed in order to develop a large kinetic scheme. On the basis of few kinetic parameters, we can develop a kinetic scheme. Again, if we are going to analyze vinyl and allyl hydrogen atom, the abstraction of hydrogen from ethylene is very difficult because in the case of ethylene, hydrogen bond is very tight, more than 100 kilocalories. While in the case of propylene, due to the fact that we are forming allyl radicals, the bond dissociation energy is only 86. So we can see in here that in respect of the red, the secondary H atom, to abstract a vinyl radical is very difficult, like the primary. To abstract an allyl radical is easier, partially like a tertiary one. But again, on the basis of few kinetic parameters, it is possible to explain the reactivity of the different H atoms. Now, let's try to analyze the H abstraction on normal octane. So we are trying to go in the area of our fuel. We want to abstract hydrogen from normal octane. If we are abstracting the terminal hydrogen atom, then in principle we have two terminal groups due to the symmetry of the molecule. We have 6 hydrogen atoms. We know already the reference kinetic parameter. We have only to multiply by 6 because we have 6 different hydrogen atoms. If we move to the formation of a secondary radical, so we are abstracting a secondary H atoms, then again for the symmetry we have 4 different H atoms, so we have to multiply by 4. But we have also to account for the fact that the secondary H abstraction are easier and they require 2.3 kilocalories less than the abstraction of a primary H atom, and the result is that we have 4 × 10⁻³ with the exponent that instead to be 13.5, it becomes 11.2 due to the benefit in terms of a lower activation energy of the CH bond in the case of secondary. If we want to consider also tertiary H atom, then the correction can be even higher, so it becomes 4.5. And 1000 Kelvin, secondary H atoms are removed 3 times faster, tertiary atoms are removed 10 times faster than the primary ones. So these are the few rules in order to define H abstraction reaction. We are forming alkyl radicals. We have seen already yesterday beta decomposition reaction. Once we form alkyl radicals, then we have a beta decomposition reaction. And beta decomposition reaction take place because the radical position is reducing the activation, the bond dissociation energy of the C-C bond in the beta position. And we can say that at least as a reference kinetic parameter, we can assume the same kinetic parameter even in the case of normal propyl and in the case of normal exyl. And dehydrogenation of alkyl radicals, they require activation energy in the order of 40 kilocalories, so are less favored than beta decomposition reaction. Now, we know already how to handle chain initiation reaction, and in principle how we can evaluate H abstraction reaction. So we can evaluate the selectivity of primary products from linear and branched alkane. Of course, chain propagation dominates the conversion of the fuel. So the selectivity, the expected results we can obtain are mainly ruled by the propagation reaction. Chain initiation are necessary in order to generate the first radicals, but after that the radicals are propagating the reaction in a very fast way. Let's say that they are conditioning the real results. Anyway, we can easily define with the rules already mentioned the chain initiation reaction. For instance, in the case of the 4-methylheptane, we can have the different possibility, one or two, depending on the symmetry. We can have the breaking of the methyl or the internal breaking, and then the activation energy is moving due to the fact that we are breaking a different bond. And in a similar way, we can evaluate the H abstraction reaction. The radical abstract hydrogen from the molecule. And they can form the five different radicals, but they can form the five different radicals. In this case, they have six hydrogen, primary hydrogen atom, four secondary, only one tertiary carbon atom in here, hydrogen atom to be abstracted, or three hydrogen primary atom in the case of the formation of this radical. So we know this kind of possibility to form radicals. We already said that if we are assuming a ratio 3 and a ratio 9 in terms of the rate to abstract secondary or primary H atom, tertiary or primary H atom, then we can easily evaluate that we expect 14% of formation of the first radical, 28, 21 or 7% roughly on the basis of this very rough rule. These are the selectivity of formation of the different radicals. On the basis of this, we can also say that the different radicals, they can decompose in a very fast way. So let's assume that they are instantaneously decomposing. And these are the decomposition products we can obtain. In this case, we can have two different decomposition products, because we can have a beta decomposition releasing the methyl group, and this is something that is less favored than the remaining, than the other path. So I put 18 versus 10. Now, indeed, what is happening inside this system is that we can also have, the red arrow, the isomerization of the alkyl radicals. So we can have H transfer from one position, so we have to account for a new class of reaction, that is, isomerization. And accounting also for isomerization, we can obtain a result like the one that is indicated in here, where it is possible to observe that, for instance, if we take this is a pentene 2, in a rough way we said 18, if we are doing a more accurate calculation accounting for isomerization, it becomes 16. And similarly, the green, that is 2-methyl pentene 1 is in here, 24 versus 21. So we see isomerization can be of importance, but they are not modifying the selectivity we have evaluated without isomerization reaction. Anyway, we have to account also for isomerization reaction. So we have to define the isomerization reaction. What are isomerization reactions? Let's say that here I'm reporting as an example the 2-methyl-pentyl radicals. And we can have an internal H abstraction. So we can have 1,5-H transfer inside the molecule. Is the transfer indicated with the red arrow on the top of this? But you see that we move from this radical to this radical due to the internal isomerization. And we can do this kind of isomerization both with a six-membered ring, 1,5-H transfer, but we can also do this with a five-membered intermediate. And with the five-membered intermediate, we have a 1,4-H transfer. If we try to see at the reference kinetic parameter for this isomerization reaction, again, in red, I reported the log A and the activation energy, and we see first of all that there is a clear difference in the activation energy for the H transfer with the intermediate, the six-membered ring intermediate, and the five-membered ring intermediate. And this is due to the fact that in the case of the five-membered ring intermediate, it is required a strain of the molecule, and the strain is in the order of 5 to 6 kilocalories. All these figures are indicative figures. I mean, you cannot search in the literature and you can obtain very nice and more accurate information related to the number, but they are only presented in order to show the way, in order to develop a possible general kinetic scheme. In the meantime, we can also observe that there are differences in the term of frequency factor, and this is simply due to the fact that in the case of the five-membered ring, we need to block one rotor less, so the frequency factor, the entropy, is different due to this fact. Now, if we try to compare isomerization and decomposition reactions, then you can observe that decomposition has an higher activation energy, 30 kilocalories. Isomerization is in the order of 15,000 kilocalories. The net result is that we can say that isomerization are important at lower temperature, or temperature lower than 1000 Kelvin, while decomposition can prevail at very high temperature. Possibly there is, I don't know if on the site there is the previous version of this slide where there was an error between decomposition and isomerization. Please eventually correct. Anyway, decomposition are prevailing at very high temperature, isomerization can prevail only at low temperature. There is the error inside. Yeah, okay. It's an error. Yeah, sorry. A subtraction. Now, let's try to analyze a complex scheme. A subtraction reaction on normal dodecane. What we have is that we have six dodecyl radicals. We can have dodecyl radical that is moving from position 1 to position 6. But we know how to evaluate the six primary, the abstraction of six primary H atoms. Then four secondary H atoms for generating the other radical. So we know the formation of the different dodecyl radicals. We know the way they can decompose, and are reported in here. So high temperature oxidation or pyrolysis is well known, or at least we already discussed the kinetic parameters. We simply need to refer to a very limited number of kinetic parameters. There are something more in respect of what I mentioned, mainly because kinetic parameters mainly depend on the type of radical, the type of H atom, so we can have a correction for the decomposition, correction for the different site of H abstraction. But in any case, we define the problem because we know the reaction classes we want to generate, we know the kinetic parameters we want to use, and it is an easy task to define an automatic generation of the primary elementary reaction and to define a detailed kinetic scheme. Because once I know the rule, I can write the reaction. Once I know the rule to evaluate the kinetic parameters, I have all the information that are needed in order to develop the kinetic scheme, even for large molecules. Here are reported H abstraction, beta decomposition reaction, isomerization, and on the basis of the rule, it was possible to generate this kind of information. Now it's clear that we have a very large dimension, so if we can succeed in reducing the dimension, then it can be very useful in order to do the successive calculation. So what we can do is to try to use directly inside the automatic generation also the reduction. Let's say that MAMMA program is a program where we are generating, first of all, we are generating all the detailed scheme. But after that, we are trying to use the quasi-steady assumption for large radicals. Why I have to maintain large alkyl radical inside the scheme? Once I know that their life is so is only limited to very few 10 minus 7, 10 minus 8 milliseconds. Then it is convenient to directly lamp the reaction. So what we are doing is the steady state approximation for large alkyl radicals. They are, sometimes they are mentioned in terms of mu radicals. Mu radical, it means radical interested only to monomolecular reactions. Monomolecular reaction, it means that we can write linear system of equation in order to solve the system and to find the, and to find the radical concentration. The meaning of this hypothesis is that at high temperature we disregard the interaction. Large radicals, they cannot interact with the remaining mixture. They have monomolecular reaction, that is isomerization or decomposition, that's all. And then we can write the continuity equation for all the radical. The radical is disappearing due to isomerization and decomposition reactions. All the radicals, they can decompose or they can isomerize. And in the meantime, the formation of the radical is due to the original formation of the radical, let's say that the formation through the H abstraction reaction that are forming a certain amount of different radicals, and then we have also a formation rate due to the isomerization. Other radicals, they are forming. But you see that this is a linear system. So it's quite easy to solve the linear system. Let's put in a similar way for normal octane. We have the formation of the four octane radicals. We know the PGA, that is the production of the four different radicals. We know the decomposition of the four different radicals. So we can write that the disappearance of all the radicals is equal to their formation. It's a linear system. We can solve the linear system, and we can have the branching ratio of this first step of reaction. And in a similar way, we can solve progressively the remaining the remaining step. Let's go back to the case of H abstraction on normal normal decay. We have five decir radicals, and what we can do is, first of all, to solve the system of these five decir radicals. On the basis of the solution of this system, we know the different weight of these reaction paths, so we know the formation of octyl radicals. After that, we are writing exactly the same equation, exactly the same equation for the octyl, for the octyl radical. So we solve the octyl radical, and we are forming exil, we are forming pentyl radicals. Then we are solving sequentially all the radicals until we are reaching only to C4. The net result is that we are transforming the H abstraction on normal decay. So instead to use all this scheme, we arrive at the lamped stoichiometry. A single reaction is representing all the previous scheme. And the single reaction is saying that H abstraction on normal decay is forming normal decil radicals. At high temperature, normal decil radicals decompose through this path. And this decomposition path we recover through the quasi-steady state assumption I mentioned before. And this is the key point. Of course, at low temperature, decil radical can interact with oxygen and can go through the low temperature oxidation path. But if it's able to decompose, then it decomposes directly, forming only radicals up to C4, because the higher radical have been already transformed through the quasi-steady state assumption. Now, large radicals are directly transformed into the decomposition and the isomerization product. Of course, this stoichiometry has been evaluated with a reference temperature, because isomerization and decomposition are different, and the reference temperature is in the range of 1000 Kelvin, and at low temperature we need to account for peroxide radical formation. But let's try to see also normal dodecane. Or better, let's try to compare the results of normal dodecane with the results of normal decay. What is important to observe is that the two reactions are very similar. H formation is 2% in both the cases, 7.38% of methyl, 25 in the case of ethyl, 22-23 in the case of butyl. The behavior, of course, of normal decane and normal dodecane is quite similar. This is an important property, and we will see why I was informed. Because what we can do is to use a vertical lumping of homologous species. What does it mean, vertical lumping of homologous species? It means that if C12 and C10 are behaving in a very similar way, I don't need to account also for C11. I can say that C11 should be 1 alpha and 1 alpha. I can mix the results in order to say, okay, what is the error? Due to the fact that 10 and 12 are similar, 11 should be in the middle. And if I move from C12, I can go directly to C16. I can skip to analyze 13, 14, 15. And I'm simply saying that C13, okay, is with the Leva rule, is the proper average between the two reference species. Again, Xin should be very similar, or better, should have an average behavior like C7 and C5. So this is something that we are calling vertical lumping. We refer only to a limited number of species instead to use all the species, and in this way we can save several dimensions in terms of scheme, several, we are reducing the number of species, and then we are also reducing the number of reactions. Now, as I mentioned, the high temperature combustion mechanism mainly go through the pyrolysis mechanism, and due to the fact that I studied in the past, the steam cracking process to produce hydrocarbon, I want to show some results we are obtaining in this condition. The steam cracking of hydrocarbon is a process where hydrocarbon feed are fed to a furnace, and at very high temperature, in the order of 900, 1100 Kelvin, they are cracked. We have a sequential beta decomposition reaction of alkyl radicals. So the reactions are exactly the same. And the interest is to produce ethylene, propylene, small olefins, butadiene, BTX, benzene, toluene, xylene, aromatics. And the feed. The feed can be ethane. So we have only a dehydrogenation of ethane to form ethylene, but we can also have naphthas or gasoil. And naphthas are the equivalent of gasoline. We are in the area of C4, C10, are always fraction coming from the refinery. Gasoils can go with the vacuum gasoil up to C35, C40. So we have a lot of possible feed, and we want to describe in a proper way the selectivity to the primary product. So the interest is an accurate prediction of alkane. Now, I mentioned this fact only in order to say that we succeed in a good simulation of the behavior of naphtha crackers or steam cracker process by using only a very limited number of molecular and radicalic species. And this was that, and this graph is reporting the different species we are using inside our model, Spiro 2000, it doesn't matter. And the different dots are referring to the fact that we have component in this class of carbon atom, and this is Z, this is, on, is Z, that is the dehydrogenation degree. So for in here we have normal and isoparaffins. The green points are referring that we are considering two different components, because we are considering one normal paraffin and a lumped species for isoparaffins. Then we have alkyl benzene, alkyl naphthalene, alkyl phenanthrene, in order to have the different behavior of all the possible components. But what we can observe is that we are only referring, let's try to see only at this, 20 carbon atom, 30 carbon atom, 30, 35, and all the intermediate points are simply obtained through the vertical lumping rule, and in this way we can strongly reduce. So the first point is that the vertical lumping homologous species are distributed between equivalent components. Then we are using the steady state approximation for large radicals, and we are strongly reducing the complexity of the scheme, and we are strongly reducing the number of radicals really involved. Finally, we are also using an horizontal lumping, because we are also lumping isomers in the class, for instance, of branched paraffin, normal and isoparaffin. Branched paraffin are grouped into a single equivalent component, that is a lumper component. And if we try to see at the number of components we have inside the liquid fraction, then we realize that it is necessary to have a strong simplification. It is necessary to have strong simplification because here are reported the carbon, the number of carbon atoms, and are reported the number of paraffin we can have inside the different families. Then is also reported the boiling temperature. But let's say that if we are staying on a diesel fuel, C15, branched paraffin C15 are more than 4,000. Branched paraffin C12 in the kerosene, in the jet fuel, are more than 300. So it is clear that we cannot describe all the components. We need to simplify. Now again, temperature is not sensitive to the structure, so we can simplify something, but we know that low temperature mechanisms are sensitive to the structure of the fuel. We have seen the explosion diagram of methane, we have seen that there are the high temperature, but is also present the low temperature mechanism, and we can say that there is a transition between high and low temperature mechanism. And what is low temperature mechanism? Low temperature mechanism is here is reported in a very simplified way. Simplified way because we move from normal decay, we form the alkyl radical, then we can form the peroxy radical, we have the isomerization, and we have the successive reaction of this. So if we want to automatically generate the low temperature reaction for all the species, then we need to define new kinetic parameters. So the new reaction classes, they require new kinetic parameters. And if we are going, for instance, to the work of Charlie Westbrook and the co-workers, there are several reaction classes. We have alkyl radical addition to oxygen, alkyl peroxy radical isomerization, alkyl radical decomposition, addition, and so on. So we know a lot of kinetic parameters for the new reaction classes, and we can, again, in the case of the new reaction classes, we can define all the classes, we can define all the kinetic parameters, we can easily go through an automatic generation again, and we have all the different reaction, in this case the isomerization from peroxy radical to alkyl hydroperoxy radicals, and then we have again the isomerization of peroxy radical, alkyl peroxy radical to peroxy. As a net result, we can have, in the case of normal dodecane, 258 primary reaction. It doesn't matter. But we have 72 intermediate radicals. And more than that, we have 58 primary products. So we have the six olefins, dodecene 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 12 heterocyclic components, 6 hydroperoxides, more than that, 30 keto hydroperoxide, alkyl hydroperoxide, carbonyl hydroperoxide. So we have quite a lot of species, and these are all the species that are directly generated by normal dodecane. They are maintaining the same carbon structure. So it is clear that in this condition can be useful to try to go through some simplification. And the simplification we are adopting, the lumping we are adopting is an horizontal lumping. We are saying, okay, it's true that from normal pentyl we are forming 5 pentyl radicals, but we can group the 5 pentyl radicals in only one equivalent pentyl radical. I don't say that the 3 radicals, they are behaving in the same way. No, we know that the first one is less important than the second. This one is the most favorable one because due to the symmetry we have only 2 hydrogen atoms that can be abstracted in here and we have 4 in here. So on some rule we can lump the different components, and we can lump the peroxy radical, we can lump the alkyl hydroperoxy radical, and all the intermediate radicals are lumped. But in the meantime we can also lump the primary species that are formed, the keto hydroperoxide, the olefins, the ethero component. So the net result is that we have a scheme like this, where these are lumped components, these are lumped radical, lumped species, and in this way we can easily see that instead to have 258 primary reactions, we have only 15 reactions. Instead to have 58 primary products, this is the important point, we have only 4 primary products. So we are strongly reducing the number of species. And if we take into account that usually the 30 keto hydroperoxide, the decomposition, the successive reaction of these 58, 30 keto hydroperoxide are always the same for all the species, then why you cannot lump directly all the species at the very beginning? So, if I take the C10, then I'm obtaining exactly the same story. Always 15 primary reaction, 4 primary products, 4 intermediate radicals, and the situation of course is very similar. Kinetic mechanism, okay, always require a well-balanced presence of primary secondary reaction. This is one of the points. Now, here I reported a comparison in the preview. In the case of normal C7, C10, C12, C14, and C16, you can see the different number of total reaction, and in the case of normal hexadecane, normal C16, we can say that we have in principle 362 reaction, and we are modifying this in only 15 reaction, and we have 100 intermediate radical, 50, 70, or whatever it is, the number of primary products that are reduced to only 4 products. How we can derive the kinetic parameters of the 15 reaction? We can simply observe at the initial decomposition, the very primary selectivity we can obtain with the detailed kinetic model, because we can have the detailed kinetic scheme. We know the kinetic scheme. We can generate the 258 reactions. We can evaluate the results of the primary decomposition of this reaction, and we simply compare the result of the detailed mechanism with the result of the lumped mechanism. We force an optimization method, and we obtain in this way, we can obtain the kinetic parameters of the lumped reaction. But look at that, we are also forcing some reaction, so we are not using all the 15 reaction, or better 15 multiplied by 2, all the 30 kinetic parameters to be optimized. Let's say that we can use, what is important is to have the proper relative weight of alternative reaction path. So we can fix, for instance, beta decomposition reaction, and we can observe the relative weight of the addition of oxygen or the reverse. In this way, it is possible to obtain some results. But what is important, to my opinion, in this result is that all the normal paraffins, they behave in a very, very similar way. All the kinetic parameters are practically the same for all the series of components moving from C10 to C16. And this fact is quite important because confirm what we already observed. Confirm what we already observed, that there are the similarity. Yesterday we have seen that there is a similarity in the laminar, in the structure of the laminar flame speed of normal alkane. For instance, normal C7 and normal C12 they behave in a very similar way in terms of CO2 production, intermediates, ethylene, and so on. This is taken from a paper of Charlie Westbrook relating to the behavior of the different normal paraffin from C7 to C16. And the clear result is that high temperature mechanism, low temperature mechanism, they are behaving in a similar way. And I can say that also the NTC behavior is not very different for the individual component. And this is a sort of confirmation to my understanding, is a confirmation of the vertical lumping, the fact that we can easily account for intermediate species with the reference to the reference one. Now, if we move from normal paraffin to isoparaffin, isoctane for instance, the lumping procedure is practically the same. The only difference is the fact that in this case we can form a alkyl hydroperoxide radical with the quaternary, quaternary carbon atom that is not able to propagate, is not able to go to the low temperature mechanism. And this is one of the reasons of the lower reactivity of isoctane in respect of normal in respect of normal heptane. So the low temperature reactivity of isoctane is drastically lower than the low temperature reactivity of normal paraffins and normal C7, for instance. And this is due to the difference in the capability or the different possibility of internal H abstraction to move from the peroxy radical to the alkyl hydroperoxy radical. So if we try to analyze the behavior of isoctane and normal heptane, we can easily see that on the basis of pure reaction, it is possible to explain the different reactivity, and we know that the different reactivity is giving rise always to the same high temperature mechanism, but to lower ignition delay time in the case of normal heptane in respect of the ignition delay time of isoctane. And let's say that this kind of behavior can be observed not only in the case of ignition delay time, but also in the rapid compression machine, can be observed in the plug flow reactor. But the NTC behavior is always practically the same, or we can observe practically always the same conditions. Now, let's go to the overall oxidation mechanism. We arrive at least at this point from hydrogen, CO, methane, we arrive to normal C7 and isoctane. Then we can include biofuels, biodiesel, alcohol inside this picture. And more than that, we have to include heavier fuels like diesel and jet fuels. And of course, there is the complexity of these liquid fuels, and we move to this portion of the to try to face and to simplify also in this case the overall structure. Crude oil and the refinery fraction in the case of complete crude oil, what we can see is that there are several fractions that can be distinguished in terms of boiling temperature, and of course boiling temperature corresponds also to the number of carbon atoms. Particularly in this case we can see that on the top we have the light gases that are only a small percentage of the fuel. Then we have light naphthas and light and heavy naphtha that are the red one. Distillate is the yellow. Then we go to atmospheric gas oil, light gas oil, heavy gas oil. So you see that a lot of the crude is in the area of gas oil. But really we can also say that the different, here are reported different crude, and different crude they can behave in a different way. There are crude with 35% of naphtha, there are crude with only 15% of naphtha, so the relative amount of the different fraction can vary through the different fuels. But what is of more interest is the relation between the boiling point and the carbon number, and we can observe that of course normal alkane have with the same carbon number has a lower boiling point in respect of aromatics, and on the reverse isoparaffins they have a lower boiling temperature. Okay, I reported some diagram in here where you can find where we can have the naphtha. Naphtha is typically between few degrees centigrade up to something like 180 centigrade. If we move from naphtha to heavier feed, light and heavy gas oil, we are in the area of 300-500 centigrade, and in term of carbon number we move from 15 to 25, so you can find in this graph, in this diagram, this kind of information. But what is important to observe in order to see the complexity of the liquid fuel is this analysis of a double GC analysis of a diesel fuel. The double GC analysis is showing us the different peaks, but we have two different retention times. So we have two different separation. One is done on the basis of the molecular weight. This is a typical GC. We can have the separation of the different peaks that are distributing the molecular weight. It's analogous to the previous one that we have already seen. But then we have a second retention time that is distributing on the basis of the dehydrogenation degree. And maybe that is more convenient to see in this. The two diagrams are practically the same. Here we can see the peak, here we can see the bubble, and the largest is the bubble, the higher is the quantity or the intensity of the peak. The red bubble are the normal paraffin. Normal paraffins are always more abundant. The blue are isoparaffins, isoalkane. So you see that there are a lot of minor bubbles that are indicating all the individual isomers inside the family. And the same is true for cycloalkane, polydaphthene. And the separation, we have the two separation, the two retention time. One is related to the carbon number, and the other one is related to the dehydrogenation degree of the different fuels, of the different isomers. But again, it's clear that we cannot recognize the individual, and we need further simplification, and we need in some way to go through surrogate mixture. We cannot use all the individual isomers. We need to define surrogate mixture because we have a lot of components, but we have also a lot of species to be considered if we want to have the tail kinetic scheme. This is a graph where I reported the number of, of species and the number of reactions in the tail kinetic mechanism. This is taken from a paper of Professor Lowe, and we see that if we are going to analyze C16, so normal hexadecane, then easily we go to have something like 2,000 species, but only to analyze normal hexadecane. How we can face with all the different branched isomers we have? It is clear that we need to simplify in a different way. Large methyl ester then are going up to 4,800 species and so on. So surrogates are a good way to simplify the system, and the surrogates provide a cleaner basis for developing and testing model and fuel property for practical fuels. Surrogates, what are surrogates? The simplest surrogate is to refer to primary reference fuels like normal heptane instead to have the gasoline. We are not saying the gasoline taken in India or in Europe. We are saying, no, we are taking a gasoline that is 98. It means 98% of isoctane, 2% of normal pentane. And of course, we can go through, analyze the gasoline surrogate, including also toluene, or we need to define surrogate for jet fuels, for diesel fuels, and in this way, something it becomes more complex. To stress the point that is necessary to refer to gas, to surrogate, here is simply reported, is an old slide taken from a Chevron site. Summer gasoline and winter gasoline are different. But again, Indian gasoline and Italian gasoline are different. In the United States, gasoline is different again. So it is clear the benefit we can have in referring to surrogate. And I say the surrogate mixture, normal heptane, octane number 0, high octane, octane number 100, a gasoline with octane number 92, it means 92 of high octane to 8% of normal heptane. So in this way, at least, we can be more stable in our definition. Ternary mixture, ternary toluene, reference mixture include also toluene in this kind of definition. So what are octane number? In here I reported the normal heptane and the isoctane, and I reported some properties of of the octane number. Particularly, you see in here that we have RON and MON. RON, it means a research octane number. MON is motor octane number. They are only referring to different engines in order to evaluate how the surrogate is really reproducing properly your gasoline, the actual gasoline, behave in a different way on different engine. So this is the limitation of the surrogate, the limitation of the definition of octane number. If we change the environment, if we change the engine, then the behavior can be in some way slightly or in some way different. Then octane number for aromatics usually is very high, is in the range of 100. Octane number for normal paraffins is of course declining. We know that becomes zero for C7. Then is further declining if we are going to C8, C9 and C10. And of course is very high for methane or ethane or whatever it is. So one way is to refer to surrogate in terms of octane number or including also toluene in our mixture. One other way that nowadays is a project that is a collaborative research program led by KAUST, that is the so-called FASE, that means fuel for advanced combustion engine, and instead to take a surrogate in terms of a mixture of a reference component, they are taking directly barrels of gasoline in order to have the same gasoline for doing experiment in different labs, trying to obtain to better compare the results. And they selected 7-9 different mixture in order to go ahead with this kind of work. Typical component in the gasoline surrogate are always referring to aromatics, cycloalkane, normal and isoctane like this. These are surrogates for gasoline. But let's go to jet fuels. The need of surrogate again is clear from this graph. In this graph are reported the percentage on the total sample analyzed in terms of density. We can see that the density for diesel, for jet fuels, moves from 78 to 84, because these are the restriction required for the jet fuels. But you understand that you can have a very different result if you are using jet fuels number 1 or jet fuels number 90. And the same is true in terms of aromatic content. Aromatic content can move typically from 10 to 25. But the shooting tendency is quite different if we are using a jet fuels with 10% of aromatics or 20% of aromatics. Then, if we include in this picture the condition of Fischer Tropsch, a synthetic fuel coming from Fischer Tropsch synthesis, then the density is something in the area of 76, and the content of aromatic is practically nil. So if we try to analyze the results of a Fischer-Tropsch alternative fuel, and the Fischer-Tropsch alternative fuel can arise from a gasification of biomasses, the formation of CO and H2, Fischer-Tropsch synthesis, and then we are obtaining a liquid fuel that is containing mainly normal and isoparaffins. So this is the typical Fischer-Tropsch fuel. And if we try to see at the soot formation, if we are adding some Fischer-Tropsch fuel to a normal jet fuel, then we have a strong declining in soot formation, and it's quite clear because we don't have aromatic inside our fuel. Now, surrogate mixture for jet fuels. Surrogate mixture for jet fuels in 5 minutes I can finish. Surrogate mixtures for jet fuels, they are typically containing normal alkane, branched alkane, cycloalkane, and aromatics. There are several definitions of possible surrogate fuels. They are referring either to 10, 15 components or only to a couple of components. Surrogate A, B, C are coming from Professor Seshadri from San Diego. And the point is to try to verify a different properties of the fuel. So we are asking the proper surrogate to mimic the property respect, for instance, in this case, the comparison are with the strain rate at extinction or the auto-ignition as a function of the strain rate, and here are reported the behavior of different surrogate fuels in respect of the experimental information. The same is true for surrogate. We have always a limited number of reference components that are used in order to define the surrogate. The different people are referring in a different way the different surrogate, and always we are referring to similar species. Now, along this road, we are practically arrived near to the end, and if we try to see at the reduction of the kinetic model we can apply in order to have a skeletal kinetic model for gasoline, jet fuel, and diesel, we see that the number of species involved by applying a lumped kinetics is always limited to 100 or 200 species. The last consideration is in here, and in all this kinetic scheme, when we are faced with normal alkane, normal system, or we are looking at aromatic soot formation, we will look eventually at the alcohols or methyl ester and so on, there is a key core that is the C0-C4 mechanism. The C0-C4 submechanism is always present in all the fuel. Yesterday we said the submechanism hydrogen oxygen is the first submechanism. It's true. Then if we are rising with the molecular weight, we are rising with the complexity of the fuel, the C0-C4 mechanism is the key point because it's common to all the other remaining detailed kinetic scheme. Now, I think that I have to discuss about biofuels, biomasses, and I think that I can do this in the afternoon when we are discussing also about solid fuel combustion. So I stop in here. I try to answer to your question. Please be very careful in the question. Or very clear in the question. Okay.
What do you mean by negative octane number and octane numbers above 100?
Okay. What is the meaning of negative octane number or octane number higher than 100? It means that you cannot reproduce with the mixture of normal heptane and isoctane that kind of particular mixture. If you have, for instance, a normal C12, is more reactive than heptane, so has a negative carbon number. If you go to some exotic aromatic component, you can have a very high octane number, and this is something higher in term. So you cannot anymore work simply with the normal heptane isoctane mixture. You need to use some trick adding other component in order to modify your reactivity. But usually gasoline is inside the that kind of limit.
And there is a change in reference also, they say, with finding the octane number. As we go negative, they have changed the reference also. How to find from the octane number that, what is the reference they use? Conventionally, it is like octane and the heptane only. Or if it is the different reference, will they specify?
Yeah, I don't know exactly how they can evaluate octane number lower than zero or higher than 100. It only depend on possibly, I'm not able to give a proper answer. I think that they are using different engine or extrapolating some other type of information. I don't know exactly.
Ignition delay times measured by short tube and rapid compression machine, why they are different, and which one to take as a reference data?
Yeah, I try to explain that the difference is mainly due to the fact that both rapid compression machine and shock tube device are not ideal system, are not completely adiabatic system. So due to the difference in respect of the ideality, they are behaving in a different way. And particularly in the case of shock tube, you cannot go ahead too much with the time because there are deviation from the idealities. And in the case of rapid compression machine, you can have heat losses that are the reason of the deviation from the ideality and a further reason of deviation between the shock tube results and rapid compression machine results.
So is there any standard methods to correct the data so that when we reduce a mechanism, we have to compare the data with the ignition limiter?
Before to compare the data, it's better to have the proper simulation conditions.
Okay.
So it is better to try to have good information relating to the facility effect. Then in that condition, you can expect better results and eventually you can use the data in order to improve the prediction of the mechanism.
Okay.
Yep.
Sir, both the shock tube and rapid compression machine, both are kind of batch reactor. And in ideally, the combusting system like gas turbine and all, this is a flow process. So the data which are generated from this batch reactors for ignition delay, how different they will be actually for the practical systems?
You mean if the information I obtain from the batch reactor are also useful for other systems?
Will it be useful because actual systems are flow processes?
Are flow, sure. But the key point is the chemistry. If I am able to properly simulate the system, then the key point is how the chemistry is able to reproduce, how the chemistry is able to justify the behavior of the batch unit. Once I know that the chemistry is correct for the batch unit, then I can use the chemistry for flow system or for different system. Before this, the question. So I use a simple system, ideal system, in order to tune and to validate the model. Once the model is validated, then I can use the model in a different environment. Of course, I can use the model in a different environment until the experiment and the validation is done in the same operating condition. If I'm validating the model at 0.01 atmosphere, and then I am using the model at 100 atmosphere, then I'm going boom from 1 to 10,000 in terms of an extrapolation that, of course, the model is not anymore reliable, or you can have all the results you can.
Sir, I have two questions. Like, suppose I need to formulate a surrogate. So what properties should I try to compare with the fuel, whether it is the boiling point or ignition delay?
Yeah.
And if I need to compare, if I want to formulate a surrogate for JTA, so what should I compare? Because JTA, what I get in India will be different.
I know the question. I understand the question. It is clear. I can define the surrogate in all the possible way I want. Particularly in the case of gasoline, I try to define the surrogate in order to maintain the same knock behavior, the same auto-ignition propensity of the fuel. So I'm using normal heptane, isoctane, I'm comparing in a standard engine, and I am obtaining the RON in order to have the same auto-ignition of the real gasoline and my surrogate in standard condition, and I'm looking on that. But let's suppose that you are studying a different story. You are studying a liquid pool and you want to have good information relating to the behavior of a liquid pool inside this liquid pool. Then you need to have the similar propensity in terms of vaporization of the fuel, and you are studying physical. So sometimes there are differences between a chemical surrogate and a physical surrogate. If you try to better match the property in terms of boiling curve or boiling propensity because you are studying a liquid, you want to analyze the way a liquid is vaporizing and so on. In the case of Chandri experiments with the auto-ignition and so on, the point was mainly to analyze the auto-ignition in respect of the vaporization from a pool and mixture of normal paraffins and xylene were useful in order to have this kind of comparison. And so it's really dependent on the type of experiment you want. But the key point of surrogate, or better, one of the key points of surrogate, is the fact that once you define a surrogate, then you can make the experiment. I can reproduce the experiment, and we have to obtain the same results. But if we are not staying on a clear definition of one surrogate, then your results and my results, they cannot be compared.
Yeah. So, but while defining surrogate, like for JETA, if I have Aachen surrogate, so what should I compare with? I am saying that this surrogate is giving ignition delay comparable to JETA, but what JETA I have, or what JETA someone in US has, that might give different ignition delays.
If your point is that to try to define the ignition delay, you want a surrogate that is behaving in a similar way in respect of that that particular property. So you try to compare the ignition delay of the real fuel with the ignition delay of the surrogate you are proposing.
Yeah, that's and, real fuel, how do you define real fuel? Because it varies and its properties will also vary. So
That is the point. And in order to reduce the variability of the fuel, you are defining one surrogate. Jet fuels can contain, as we have seen before, it's clear that I cannot have let's say that we are referring to a jet fuel.
Yes.
And we take the average of jet fuel, and we want to emulate the properties of the average jet
fuel.
So we take the average and we try to have a surrogate that is reproducing in a reasonable way the average of that.
One more question. The graph where you showed the population density of soot particles, where you showed two peaks at 10 micron and 100 micron, number of soot particles formed.
Yeah.
So is it same for all fuels or all conditions, or it varies with the type
no,
of flame?
No. Clearly it varies depending on the fuel. Okay. If you go to the distribution of the typical distribution of diameter, let's say that in the case of gasoline, usually you have a lot of small particles. In the case of diesel, you increase the number of bigger particles, but you decrease the number of smaller particles. Of course, there is also transformation. You are going from small particles to generate the bigger one. So if you are moving from the burner and you are going far from the burner, gradually smaller particles, they collide and they grow up in term of dimension, so also the distribution is moving along the dimension, along the diameter.
Thanks.
Okay.
So how are you choosing which compounds to use for constructing a surrogate? Like, if you use compounds with a broad enough range in properties, you can always create a combination of them so that the property matches. So which compounds do you use? Like, how do you decide which compounds to use?
Which component are you using for the surrogate?
Yes.
Yeah, this is a okay. Let's say that these are typical components used for surrogate of gasoline. In the case of gasoline, these are always, is a slide coming from Kaust, from Professor Sarati. They are using surrogate mainly referring to normal butane and normal heptane for normal paraffins. Isopentane, 2,5-dimethylhexane, 2,2,4,3-methylpentane, it is the usual isoctane, cyclohexane and cyclopentane together with one hexene in terms of cycloalkane and olefins and alkenes, and 1,2,4-3-methylbenzene and toluene in terms of aromatics.
So, is there any underlying reason why you're choosing only these compounds?
Yeah, one of the reasons is that you need to have the kinetic model for the individual component, because you want to use the surrogate and you want to use the surrogate in order to validate the model. So you say, okay, I try to put in my scheme this kind of component, I have surrogated are referring only to this component in order to be able to have a proper simulation of my experimental result, experimental data. Of course, this is depending particularly on Professor Sarati in Kaust. Other people are selecting other species, but gadolin, normal heptane, isoctane, toluene are the typical reference fuels. Then, let's say from Lawrence Livermore Laboratories, they are also using one hexene, including one hexene for having also the the possibility to simulate or to increase the capability of surrogate definition. If we are moving to heavier feed, there are a lot of people that are only staying on normal paraffins. Normal decane is a good surrogate for jet fuels, or normal dodecane is a good surrogate for jet fuels. Then other people say, no, we want to include also xylene, or we want to include 3-methylbenzene. So it's really depending on the different area where people is working, and from our side, let's say that we are trying to develop models that are covering surrogates proposed by people that are doing experiments. Let's say that in Milano we are not doing experiments, so we have the model and we try to cover the different surrogates depending on the request. But it's clear that always it's necessary to maintain a limited number of species, mainly in order to avoid an explosion in terms of dimension of the scheme and also difficulties in organizing the proper surrogate.
So there is no like systematic procedure to reduce from full description of fuel to...
Let's say that if, Carl, if you want to complete my answer, there are other different rules in order to properly select surrogate.
The key point is the following. First, you have to decide what you want to reproduce. So you would say, let's say if you want you have to make a decision on what aspects of combustion of the practical fuel you are employing. What aspect do I want to reproduce? Okay. So let's say if you're interested in reproducing critical conditions of extinction, autoignition, whatever. Then you develop a surrogate. Then you have to look for components of the surrogate. For example, if you're looking at JP8, then you know roughly what the aromatic aliphatic mixture is. So then you select. Then the question: what components do you select? You select components based on for which chemistry is available. Let's say you have component A, which is better than component B, but component A does not have chemistry, then you select component B. Okay. So now you have a surrogate mixture, which is pretty close to what the practical fuel has, the aromatics and the aliphatic content. And then one does an experiment, simple bench scale experiments, to see if it reproduces the aspects we want it to reproduce. Okay? And that's how the surrogate is developed. Now, this particular surrogate, you can't use it beyond for what it is developed. For example, if I developed a surrogate for ignition delay and auto-ignition, you cannot use that to form soot formation, because it was not developed for that application.
Okay, right. Okay,
just stop for one last question from Dr. Ramon. Hello, Professor Ranzi. In one of the slides, you have shown that for normal alkanes from C7 to C16, the ignition delay times are almost similar. Right? If that is the case, why the CTA numbers are different? If I am correct, the CTA number of normal heptane is around 50. Whereas for hexadecane, it is around 80, right? So if ignition delay times are almost similar, why do the CTA numbers are different?
Yeah, probably should be due to the different diffusion of the two fuels and the different boiling temperature of the two fuels. So in certain number, maybe that also the vaporization play a role.
So you mean to say that the physical delay may be a factor here?
I can stay on the fact that from a chemical point of view, the ignition delay time are exactly the same for normal C10 and normal C16. Are exactly the same. Now you are saying that a certain number is different. The meaning is that it's not only the chemistry that is ruling the certain number. I can ask the professor here to give a better answer. I can say that chemistry is there. So from a chemical point of view, the ignition delay time are the same.
But C10 number should capture the ignition delay characteristically. It should define the ignition quality of the fuel.
It is not anymore ignition delay time dictated by the chemistry. So I needed to refer to something else, to something different.
Vaporization rate also in the experiment that determines.
Okay. So you mean to say that the physical delay may be a factor here?
In the ignition itself.
Yeah, the ignition is limited by the vaporization rate.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks for the support. Thanks for the support.
Thanks, Professor Renzi.
Thank you.
Since we are in the middle of the day, we need to stop. Otherwise, yesterday we saw that we weren't quite stopping you. And we will have a similar situation this afternoon as well at the end of the day, and you can ask questions indefinitely. But right now I think we want to go for lunch, and since we are about half an hour late right now, we will and then we have been given 1.5 hours for lunch. We will try to cut short that by 15 minutes, so we will try to have Professor Seshadri's second talk for today at 2:15. And you take your 1.5 hours or more, and then we will think about pruning the coffee break at the time. And, so on.